the Dynamic Duel Podcast, a weekly show where we review superhero films and debate the superiority between Marvel and DC by comparing their characters in stat-based battle simulations. I'm Johnny DC, and in this episode, Marvelous Joe will not be in attendance. He's spending time with his adorable newborn daughter, Ella, taking care of her and his wife, both of whom are doing great. So congrats to Joseph and Ariana. Our family is super proud. Since Joseph was unable to get out and see the latest Marvel film to hit theaters, Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, I will be reviewing that later in this episode with my good friend Adam Spies, probably most well known as the co-host of the Blast From Our Past podcast. There's no news breakdown this episode, but since Joseph's gone, and right now I could do whatever I want, I'm going to take this time to remind all of you that tickets for The Flash are on sale. After seeing Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, I gotta say the similarities between the two films are a little disheartening, and comparisons are going to be inevitable. But The Flash is the better movie. And I know, all of you right now are like, oh, you're just saying The Flash is better than Spider-Verse because you're biased. To which I would say, hey, which one of us has actually seen both movies, huh? Make sure you get your Flash tickets like right now. Go ahead and pause this episode. It won't hurt my feelings. It will hurt my feelings if The Flash does not have a bigger opening weekend than Across the Spider-Verse. I've got my tickets. All the cool kids do. Even my kids. But speaking of kids, mine and Joseph's newborn, that brings us to this week's question of the week. What child or offspring of a Marvel or DC superhero is your favorite, and why? Record your answer at dynamicduel.com by clicking on the red microphone button in the bottom right-hand corner, which will prompt you to leave us a voicemail. Your message could be up to 30 seconds long, and don't forget to leave your name in case we include you on the podcast. We'll pick our favorite answer and award that person a Dynamic Duel No Prize that we'll post to Instagram and our email newsletter. Be sure to answer before June 10th. Those of you who have listened to recent episodes will know that our duel simulator has become so advanced that it's gained sentience and has named itself the Artificial Lifeform for Running Extensive Duels, just a rather very intelligent simulator 9000, or Alfred Jarvis 9000. Here's a quick message for our listeners, so let's hear it.
Why, hello there. Do you love listening and chatting about Marvel and DC? Then become a part of the Dynamic Duel community on Patreon, where you can choose from three tiers. The Dynamic 2.0 tier lets you listen to this podcast without ads and gives you access to its Discord chat group, where you can chat with Johnny DC and Marvelous Joe. The Fantastic Four tier gives you that and more, with two bonus episodes each month, including bloopers and top 10 shows where Johnny and Joe count down your favorite Marvel and DC subjects. The X-Force tier makes you an executive producer of Dynamic Duel, where every month you help the host choose what to review and who to fight against each other. And finally, the Dynamike Podcast Network tier allows aspiring podcasters to create their own battle-focused show using this Monte Carlo simulator. Johnny and Joe will help you develop your show, provide graphic support and consultation, and get you simulation results to announce on your show. Pitch the twins your show via email at dynamicduelpodcast@gmail.com or by reaching out to them on social media. Check it out at patreon.com/dynamicduel. Pip pip cheerio.
Thanks AJ9K, and thanks to everyone who supports the podcast, including our newest patron, Abner Oteri. Abner, if you haven't already, make sure when you join our Discord to let us know whether you're on Team Marvel or Team DC. I'm trusting you to make the right decision here. But with that out of the way, quick to the no prize. A no prize is an award that Marvel used to give out to fans. Our version, the Dynamic Duel No Prize, is a digital award that we post on Instagram and in our email newsletter for the person that we feel gave the best answer to our question of the week. Last week, we asked, what is your favorite time-traveling Marvel or DC film or television show, and why? We got a number of answers, so let me break down the honorable mentions before revealing this week's no prize winner. Our first honorable mention goes to Colby Hinches, who said,
hey boys, Colby Hinches. The best use of time travel in a Marvel or DC film is Dormammu, I've come to bargain. Doctor Strange didn't try to go change the past or fix anything from the future. He fought a foe he knew he couldn't beat by holding him in a time loop, and that holding him required him to die thousands of times. But he did it. It was the most heroic and my favorite use of time travel.
Yeah, the time loop at the end of the first Doctor Strange movie was definitely one of the more creative ways that a superhero has ever defeated a supervillain on screen. The fact that, like you mentioned, Doctor Strange had to die thousands of times and knowing that he was going to have to go through that was a true act of heroism. So yeah, not a conventional use of time travel, but a time loop is definitely a great example of how it can be done in a unique way. Our next honorable mention goes to Miggy Matangian, who said,
"Hey, what's up guys, this is Miggy, and my favorite time traveling DC show is Young Justice Phantoms, because it was a well-crafted season with great story arcs that refocused on the core team, it had good character development, and it dealt with larger themes and issues like racial prejudice and mental health. The time travel aspect of the season was great because it, spoilers, reimagined the Legion of Superheroes origin, introduced new characters and concepts like Lor Zod and Ursa Zod being the Emerald Empress, and showcased Nightwing's detective skills."
Young Justice is a fantastic DC animated series that really does a terrific job of streamlining and reimagining some of DC's more convoluted continuity. The Legion of Superheroes being amongst the most convoluted continuity of all DC properties. It's probably one of the reasons why I haven't done too many dual episodes with those characters. It's a shame that Young Justice has not been renewed for another season. If you haven't seen it, if you're a DC fan and you enjoy those characters, I definitely recommend watching it. Even if you don't enjoy the characters, the show is just really well made. So great answer, Miggy. Our final honorable mention goes to Connor Pierce, who said,
"G'day, my favorite DC/time travel movie is Justice League Dark Apocalypse War. The ending shows Constantine slips away and goes to the Flash saying, 'You know what you have to do, mate, clear the board and start again,' which makes him start a new Flash point. So he travels through time to reset the universe. And that's my favorite."
The ending of Justice League Dark Apocalypse War was so devastating in the fact that all of these characters were just kind of sitting there and just waiting for the world to end. When Constantine tells the Flash to basically reset everything so that they were all saved from this, it was a very heartbreaking moment and definitely one that left the audience moved as, you know, the screen faded to black. It was not the ending I think anyone ever expected. I was very surprised by it. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's one of the best examples of time travel. Great answer, Connor Pierce. But the winner of this week's No Prize is Christopher Minotti, who said,
"My favorite time traveling film is Flashpoint. There's not enough good things that I can say about this, but the big two points are how well it tells the story and how well it shows off the differences between each character's lives, especially with Flashpoint Batman and the Flash. They all seem to have a big twist that in their life that just makes it really interesting."
Flashpoint was one of the most impactful uses of time travel in Marvel and DC comics. It literally reset the DC universe continuity. And the animated film adaptation was just incredible. Getting to see Thomas Wayne as Batman and all of the other character variations that make things like time travel very exciting because of the twists that you get to see. It was just loaded with fan service for fans of the comic storyline. And yeah, I gotta agree, it's one of the best uses of time travel in Marvel and DC's history. So congrats to Christopher Minotti for winning this week's No Prize. If you, the listener, want a shot at winning your own No Prize, make sure you visit our website and record your own answer to our question of the week. But now that all of that's done, let's move on to the main event of this episode, where I get Adam Spies on the line and we talk all about Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse is the latest film in Sony's animated Spider-Verse saga and is the sequel to 2018's Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, which wowed critics with its groundbreaking style of animation that earned it the Academy Award for Best Animated Film. Into the Spider-Verse is regarded as one of the best superhero movies of all time, so there are a lot of people that have been looking forward to this sequel, including my good friend, former co-worker, and podcaster extraordinaire, Adam Spies, who's helping me review this film. How's it going, Adam?
Hey, Jonathan. It is going very good and even better now that I've seen this movie.
Yeah, you're the host of several podcasts, you know, Cartwright, a Seinfeld podcast, mm-hmm. Throwback Trivia Takedown, and of course, Blast from Our Past podcast, in which you talk a lot about the movies of yesteryear, but mm-hmm. you don't often record thoughts on films still in theaters, right?
Correct. We've never talked about much about theater movies. I mean, it may be in passing, but we're not doing a full breakdown of it.
Yeah. Now, so we rated Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, the first movie, 4.5 out of 5 stars back in 2018 when we reviewed it. Joseph gives me crap about that all the time.
He should. It's a five. It's a five movie without question. It is a five.
Yeah, I will admit that. I think it's one of several films that we've probably underrated on this podcast, like Into the Spider-Verse, Joker, my opinion, Wonder Woman. But,
yeah,
you know.
I'd agree with all that.
What did you think of the first movie?
The first movie, literally, I think the only thing left of me in the movie theater were my socks, because I got knocked out of them, baby. The visuals, the incorporation of music, everything about that movie was phenomenal. And obviously, the best part was something I had not really seen before in one of like these comic book movies, which was adapting from page to screen. Nothing had done such a equal transfer of comic book to movie that I've ever seen before. Maybe Scott Pilgrim vs. the World did a really good job of that and some other ones. But the way it used visual space to still kind of give you panels like a comic book does, it was incredible. It's like nothing I'd actually seen throughout an entire movie.
Yeah, both of these films, just in terms of the animation style, nothing quite has come close to seeing a comic book brought to life.
Yeah,
just with the illustration style and even like the color misalignment and things like that, the dynamic poses that you could do with these characters that you could never achieve in live action and the different angles that go with them. Spider-Man is rumored to be a very popular character for artists to draw because you could just do so many things with that character that you can't do with anyone else, really. Like, seeing Superman in a Spider-Man pose just seems really weird, right?
So yeah.
So what they're able to achieve here, I think, is absolutely groundbreaking. You know, there are some who would say that Into the Spider-Verse is the best Spider-Man movie. And while I'm not sure I agree, I definitely think Into the Spider-Verse is better than Across the Spider-Verse, but only because Across the Spider-Verse is half of a story.
Yeah, and I agree with that.
I've seen some reviews that compared this film to Avengers Infinity War, The Empire Strikes Back, and The Dark Knight. And I'm like, whoa, calm down, people. Like, that's a bit much. And don't get me wrong, like, I liked Across the Spider-Verse, and I'm definitely recommending people see it in movie theaters, especially before listening to this spoiler review. The film is quite literally a work of art, and probably the most ambitious animated film I've ever seen in terms of like the various animation styles present within the film. Each world we visit in the movie truly feels unique, like whether it's the emotive watercolor backgrounds of Gwen's universe or the neon underglow of Earth 42, it's all quite a sight to behold.
Yeah, it takes visuals and the art of animation to an entire another level on this. Even more so, it pushes boundaries of what you can optically suck in, you know, what you can actually like take visually,
what your mind can interpret.
Yes. And I appreciate how far with every different universe that we went to and every different character had so much differences in their styles. And you just had to follow along. You just had to soak it all in. And it was a bit much at times. That was almost to its detriment, I will say. There were times, especially with some of Gwen's scenes, where I was just like sensory overload, but I was interested. I was in for it.
This film doesn't seem quite to be as commercial or as like
easily accessible as the first one, just because of the animation tricks that they do, like in Gwen's universe, when they're constantly shifting the background. I've seen stuff like that in anime, though I don't watch a lot of anime. And I'm really curious to see how Western audiences, especially young children, because, you know, it's an animated film, will respond to that.
Don't take someone with epilepsy, is what I'll say.
For sure. For sure. Yeah. I mean, the movie's doing gangbusters in its opening weekend box office so far, so kudos to the filmmakers there. Now, I mentioned, you know, the other films that people are comparing this one to. I can somewhat see how someone could compare it to The Dark Knight because of how highly influential the style of the film is on the genre. You know, just take a look at how the latest Puss in Boots or Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles films look as evidence of that. Mm-hmm. But the reveal at the end of this film, that twist, that Miles is trapped in a universe without Spider-Man, where he became the Prowler, is, I'm sorry, like nowhere near as devastating as Thanos' snap or Luke Skywalker learning that the guy who just cut off his hand is his father. I mean, is it just me? Like, is this my anti-Marvel bias that made this ending that everybody's talking about seem lackluster?
It wasn't lackluster, but what I will say is the connection is the cliffhanger. I think that's what people are making that connection to some of those other movies. This is not as dramatic of an ending as Infinity War and Empire Strikes Back. And honestly, those movies also had a more proper ending to them.
Right.
Like, they actually ended and you're like, oh my God, this story right here is done. We have to move on to the next movie to get that next story. Here, right. It absolutely feels like we were cut off halfway through the story. And I didn't like that. That will be one of my knocks on the movie. Uh-huh. It felt a little bit almost like Walking Dead when Negan had the baseball bat and, you know, you didn't know who he killed. And that's when I stopped watching Walking Dead because I was like, you know what? Screw you. I did not like this cliffhanger. But I will continue to watch the next Spider-Verse movie, of course. I think that's where the connections are, but it didn't do the cliffhanger the way I wanted it. It was a little bit too abrupt. Like, I was literally edge of my seat, ready to see, how's he going to get out of this situation?
Yeah.
And then it just ended. I was like, are you kidding me? Are you effing kidding me right now? I'm not done. Right. I would sit for another 2 straight hours. I want everything right now. I don't want to wait.
Absolutely. No, I love binging like long form content. I get shit all the time for liking movies like The Batman and Zack Snyder's Justice League. At this point, like, I don't mind just sitting on my couch binging 6 hours of television on a Saturday when I got nothing else to do, when the lawn is mowed and everything. I'm there for it.
Yeah. I mean, for those really long ones, give me an intermission, you know, give me that 10, 15 minutes, get my pee break and get some popcorn and I'll go right back in or whatever and I'm good to go. Or if you're at home, you can pause and you're set. I like long stories. I want to have a full story told to me. We're all used to binge culture now where you can get everything at once. Yeah. I don't want to wait, damn it, another year for the next movie to come out.
Right? Like an entire year. That's excessive, it feels like.
Yeah.
I feel like most audience members maybe have been shocked because they didn't know the film was going to end with a cliffhanger. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's where the surprise is coming from. But of course, like anyone who listens to this podcast knew that this film, like the last 2 Harry Potter or Hobbit or Hunger Game movies, split the story in half so they could tell it over the course of 2 films. And I wasn't thrilled when I first learned that this film was going to do that, because that usually means that they're going to like pad the runtime with useless side story to make the movie drag. But I will say that while there was some pacing issues here, they were largely minimal. And it was really easy to get distracted by the gorgeous visuals to really care about them. The movie was like 2.5 hours long, like around there, but it didn't feel like that to me at all, which is nice.
No, it was comfortable. I had no issues sitting and watching the movie. I agree that there was maybe a little bit of padding, particularly in Miles's storyline. Like, they kind of repeated beats where it's just like, okay, we get it. He's having trouble with his parents and all this kind of stuff. We can move along. But you're right. I was distracted by the visuals. I was just, you know, jaw dropped like, oh, me likey. And so I was a happy boy.
Right. And like the slow parts in the beginning with like his family and stuff, I felt like they also carried the brunt of the thematic weight of this film. You know, those themes revolving around really 2 main themes here. There was the notions of longing and belonging, which I felt like are probably too mature for younger audiences, which is another reason why I think like this film isn't really for kids in a way. I think adults will definitely appreciate it more.
Yeah, I agree. And it definitely tie in as a theme. I guess you would say with longing for a father figure, that is something that Peter Parker deals with his entire story arc throughout of all the comics, is the father figures that he has, the good ones, they die on him.
Right.
And then the other father figures he's got, the Doc Ocks and the Harry Osborns, they're psycho killers. Like, he's having these issues with father figures and just all the good ones are dying off on him. And that's obviously what is a big story arc. One of those nodes, if you will, one of those canon events right. that every Spider-Man has to deal with.
Yeah. The sense of loss and, mm-hmm. and longing. Absolutely. Yeah, totally. And we learned in the first film that anyone can be Spider-Man, you know, as long as they help others and never give up. This film takes that and turns it on its head as Miles learns that he should not be Spider-Man, according to Miguel O'Hara, the leader of the Multiversal Watch Group made up of Spider-Man known as the Spider Society. In the movie, Miles' mom expressed to him that she was afraid of him going out into a world that would make him feel that he didn't belong. And while that was exactly what happened to him, Miles refuses to accept that he shouldn't be Spider-Man, as he proves himself capable of outmaneuvering all the rest of the multiverse's Spider-Man yeah. and escaping them.
Yeah, that twist, if you will, it does cause some questions for me, just storytelling-wise. Uh-huh. Obviously, the spider from Universe 42 came into his dimension, his universe, and then bit him. So there was no Spider-Man for 42. And then that's right. why Miles became Prowler.
Right.
So if that spider came into his universe, does that not mean there should be another spider that bit a different person? There should be a second Spider-Man in his universe? Or was he destined to be Spider-Man in that universe? Which one is it?
Right? No, there's some story inconsistencies like that I also noticed. Like, if canon events not occurring essentially destroy that universe, then why does Universe 42 even exist?
Yeah.
Like, if Spider-Man wasn't able to exist inside of it, you know?
Sure.
And, like, why did Miles get a glimpse of his father dying?
If he's not really Spider-Man, why would his captain father die at all?
Right. Exactly. I also wondered, like, why these canon events arbitrarily required the death of a captain. You know, it's not like Captain America died in the MCU. You know, we didn't see Captain Stacy die in the Raimi films or a captain die in the video mm-hmm. game. Or I'm assuming many of the cartoons. It just felt so random to me in this movie. I was just like left scratching my head like, okay, just kind of went along with it.
Yeah, I do theorize in the next movie, we are going to find out that Miguel O'Hara is wrong, that Miles Morales is the destined Spider-Man. He is tied in with being Spider-Man. He is, you know, mm-hmm. just as worthy as any of the others, and kind of anybody can be that Spider-Man. And maybe this canon event thing, at least for him, doesn't mean shit.
Right. Yeah, I'm definitely hoping some of the discrepancies with this story are addressed in the sequel, Beyond the Spider-Verse. I don't know how many of them will be, but I hope at least some of them are, and that'll be enough for me. One of the reasons the first film, I think, is so beloved is because its diverse cast of characters made the film more relatable to a broader audience. And I think the thematic need to belong rooted in this film is just as relatable. Like, the fact that Miles overcame that need while recognizing his own self-worth was also empowering, and I think is resonating amongst audiences just as much.
Oh, yeah, wholeheartedly agree. I loved having that much diversity. I loved seeing so many different characters in general. I mean, all different types. Anybody can be Spider-Man, because we see in different universes, literally every type of person is yeah. a Spider-Man or a Spider-Woman. And so it's great to see that. And it also just adds to the fun, you know? If we get just one type of Spider-Man, all right, we don't want them all to be the exact same. Right. I loved seeing Mombatan and yeah. getting the Indian Spider-Man and all these, and, you know, all of our other friends back.
So. Yeah, so some of my favorite stories in comics are Elseworld stories, where we get mm-hmm. these, like, interesting twists on characters that we know, because you could do things in those stories that you can't do in, like, the main canon of the main universe. So being able to see characters like Spider-Man India on screen is really cool. And just, like, the plethora of yeah. other Spider-Men that they seemingly had in the Spider Society, it was amazing just to see each one, like, so well designed. It seemed like a lot of thought went into that.
Oh, yeah. And every Marvel and, you know, 90s Spider-Man watching nerd, where, because that 90s cartoon really brought on the Spider-Verse for us. At the kind of the last arc of that show, basically did this with Madame Web and like this. You saw all these other different ones, different Spider-Mans come together to kind of save the multiverse. And it just felt like that again, honestly, on a much bigger scale. And there was just so many different cameos. I loved seeing all these different Spider-Man. And the vast majority, I didn't even recognize. But the ones that I did, I was just like, oh, my God, yes. Oh, there's the spider car and all this other stuff. Yeah. It was so good.
Scarlet Spider. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I love Ben Reilly.
No, what I fear audiences won't respond to in this movie is like the comic book jargon and Easter eggs loaded into the film. I saw the film with my wife and daughters, and they said they were lost for a majority of the movie. Like, they didn't care that Donald Glover made a cameo as the Prowler, or that the Spot stumbles upon the bodega lady from the Venom films. You know, that and a bunch of other random cameos and references were completely lost on them. And I feel like unless you see all of the movies and read all of the comics and see all of the cartoons and play all the video games, there's really too much crammed into the film to fully appreciate. I definitely feel like I didn't capture everything just with this first viewing. And, you know, I'm definitely curious to see how much more I absorb upon subsequent viewings.
Yeah, I'm going to be happy with other viewings, but, you know, you can tell your wife and daughter to shove it because I enjoyed all those other cameos. I mean, it is nice. It's further proof. Yes, we want all these movies to somehow interweave, and seeing, you know, that quick Donald Glover in there and seeing the Venom stuff, like, it's like, oh man, we are in this vast multiverse where all these crazy films that we're like, man, do these connect? How do they connect? And they do somehow. Some right. weird, wild, wacky Spider-Verse way you can get from one of them to the other. And I thought that was great.
The Donald Glover moment was actually, I think, particularly important just because Donald Glover himself inspired the character of Miles mm-hmm. Morales, according to Miles Morales' creator. There yeah. was a scene in Community, the television show, where Donald Glover was wearing a Spider-Man outfit and wanted to be Spider-Man. And so the writer of the Ultimate Spider-Man comics created Miles Morales based off of that. So to see it all come full circle where Donald Glover gets to make an appearance in a Spider-Man film starring Miles Morales is pretty cool.
Yeah.
But I think that does it for like the overall thoughts. Let's move on to the character breakdown, starting with Miles Morales. He's voiced by Shameik Moore, and he does a fantastic job as Miles. Like, mm-hmm. not only does he manage to make him both geeky and cool, but he captures the emotion and humor of the character that you can't help but root for him.
Yeah, he's extremely likable. He's just trying to balance this world. I mean, that's the life of Peter Parker. That's the life of Spider-Man, Miles Morales, etc., is the balance. Literally, you cannot have your cake and eat it too. And shown in the scenes where he's trying to carry two cakes and this kind of stuff, they fall apart. And, you know, everything is all this stuff that he's doing falls apart.
You can't juggle everything.
Exactly.
That's true. That's true. That's definitely the life of Spider-Man.
Yeah. You know, but his voice performance, it shines through. He does a great job of, I would say, emoting and connecting to the audience.
Like, so much so, like, I'm ready to see Shameik Moore play the character in live action. I think he would do a fantastic job.
Yeah, I want to see him in more stuff live action, period. I think, you know, I mean, he's a good looking dude. He can definitely obviously act to some extent, even with his voice. So, yeah, I want to see him. I want to see him around.
I saw part of Dope. I didn't see the whole thing, but from what I saw, I thought he did a great job. It's time. We need to see him in the next MCU film as Miles Morales.
Let's do it.
Now, I mentioned the themes of the film were longing and belonging, and Miles starts the film longing for his friends. At the end of the first film, Peter P. Parker and Spider-Gwen, his mentor and love interest, respectively, leave Miles and return to their own universes. So Miles is forced to deal with the hardships as Spider-Man alone, and he plans on studying the multiverse in college to someday make his way back to his friends. That, of course, changes when Gwen returns and Miles decides to follow her across the Spider-Verse while learning all about an exclusive society for Spider-Men that he wants to be a part of. When he's shunned and hunted for wanting to save his father and break the society's rules, he learns that he's not a part of the society because he's an anomaly. The spider that bit him and gave him powers came from another universe, Earth 42. He's faced essentially with the trolley problem, moral experiment, and chooses to save his father at the risk of destroying his universe because he realizes that the people he truly belongs with are his family. And you would think that the spider people would have recognized how villainous they were coming across as, because mm-hmm. they were essentially trying to push Miles to let his father just die, just to let him be killed. And it's like, what kind of heroes are these spider people?
I think they're a little bit of sheep. I think they're just kind of following Spider-Man 2099 a little too much at this point. Even though Jessica Drew and Peter B. Parker and Gwen all kind of followed him reluctantly, they did hesitate for a bit. All the other Spider-Men are just kind of lemmings.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I was most surprised that Gwen was kind of playing along because she was so close to Miles. Definitely seemed to have feelings for him at the very least. Gwen was, of course, played by Hailee Steinfeld. She does a good job. She just has a great voice. Hailee Steinfeld can be in pretty much every movie, and I would not have a problem with it.
Yeah, she was great as the new Hawkeye. She's great as Spider-Gwen. I loved her. And I loved how much more we got from her and her story. And she had great emotion in this movie.
The film starts with her, surprisingly enough. We definitely got to see much more backstory for the character in this film and, you know, how she accidentally killed her universe's Peter Parker and how her father, Captain Stacy, tries to arrest her for it even after he learns Spider-Girl is his daughter. That was crazy. It's a rough and emotional backstory. And it's easy to see how she relates to Miles's feelings of abandonment, but also why she's reluctant to reveal too much information to him, because then she would get kicked out of the society, you know, and be forced to go back and deal with her father. And, you know, she basically is forced to do that exactly late in the film, only to learn that her father grew more compassionate in her absence. And, you know, after realizing that Miles never made it back to his universe, she assembles a team of spider people to go find him. And that's where we leave the character at the end of this film.
Yeah, it's really nice to see, again, tying in. Loss is a part of every Spider-Man. And yes, I understand Miles is fighting against that. But I mean, he already had loss. He had his uncle.
Right.
You know, we don't need to have him lose his father, too. Damn it. Like, let him have a couple people.
Right.
But yeah, I really enjoyed seeing her story and seeing how she had to cope with loss to become the Spider-Woman that she is today.
We haven't done a dual episode with Spider-Gwen, but we need to. Spider-Man is such a unique character. It's always kind of a challenge to find someone to pit him against. Mm-hmm. Of course, we have done a duel with Spider-Man 2099, aka Miguel O'Hara, who in this film was voiced by Oscar Isaac. Oscar Isaac is everywhere nowadays and seemingly won't stop until he's performed as a character in every major fandom universe that exists. Everything from Star Wars to X-Men movies.
Man, he's making his way into so many different, like, nerddom. He's like the king of the nerds right now.
Right? Now, I guess you could say that he's the villain of the film, maybe since, like, the film's climactic battle involves him. But, of course, you know, the central conflict, the central threat still revolves around the Spot. I'd say the film has a villain problem in that it, like, loses focus on the main threat and, you know, warps the Miguel O'Hara character into a villain for the purposes of padding runtime.
Yeah.
But in all honesty, it does work. So maybe it's less of a villain problem than it is a villain, I don't know, hiccup.
Yeah, I would agree with that. To me, it kind of felt like, all right, we are establishing the Spot. He's kind of growing and growing into his power. And then they just kind of forgot about him in the third act.
Right.
Like, the Spot just kind of stopped being a problem. I'm like, wait a minute, isn't he still amassing power and causing these issues?
Right.
And then they just totally focused on Miles and Miguel and all this kind of stuff, to where I was like, wait a minute, what happened to the Spot?
Exactly. It's like, isn't he still a threat? Shouldn't you guys be chasing him down? What's going on?
Mm-hmm.
By the end of the film, I wasn't quite sure, like, what villain to be most worried about. Like, Miles already revealed he could handle himself against Miguel, and it's not like Miguel's team of Ben Reilly and Jessica Drew were threatening. You know, one was an idiot and the other was pregnant. So
how did that make you feel as a father? Did that make you a little afraid for her?
I don't like the idea of it. Honestly, I'm going to be honest. I don't know who the father was, but if my wife was out there pregnant fighting crime, I'd be like, no, let's keep you safe. You're going to trip and fall. It's not going to be good.
I mean, I know she's, you know, enhanced as Spider-Woman, but yeah, it was a little interesting choice. And similarly, I kind of thought Peter B. Parker was a bad father in this movie.
Yeah, getting his toddler daughter involved in superheroics a little too early. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I do like Mayday Parker, though. I think she's a great Spider-Girl in the comics. I was glad to see her make an appearance of sorts. I am wondering if maybe in the sequel we'll get to see, like, the adult, fully realized version of Spider-Girl. Maybe not, but a guy could hope. I'm also looking forward to seeing how Miguel's character changes in the next film. Like, it'll be cool to see them explore more of his, like, bestial side with, like, the vampire fangs when he inevitably joins Miles in the fight against Spot and maybe the Prowler as well.
Yeah, exactly. I think they're gonna have to appeal to his fatherhood. Like, he you know, he's obviously, again, fatherhood and father figures being a theme here. With Miguel and Peter B. Parker, they want to be fathers so badly, and Miguel wanted to be so badly. He was in another universe for that, and
right.
he caused issues with that. But obviously, you know, that's also been part of his downfall. I think he's definitely going to make a turn. He's going to be one of our heroes at some point in the next film.
Yeah, it'll be cool to see all the Spider-Man go up against, you know, whatever threats. I don't know if the Spot's going to team up with the Prowler or what's going to go on, but I know it's going to be awesome.
Yes.
Moving on to one of those threats, the Spot, a.k.a. Dr. Jonathan Ohn. He was voiced by Jason Schwartzman, who did a great job capturing, you know, both the ridiculousness of the character and the menace as well.
Yeah, he looked so awkward, but in a perfect way. He kind of had these long, lanky legs, like a squatty top half of his body.
Yeah.
Just kind of the way he stood was kind of awkward, but it fit really well with Jason Schwartzman. And Spot as a ridiculous character in general. Him as a villain, I thought worked really well. Now, granted, did he go from I'm just trying to steal some money from an ATM to the end of the movie where I'm going to kill you, Miles, and all your fucking family, all right. this kind of stuff. It was a bit of not a stretch, but you saw him ramp up pretty hard.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But I was there for it.
Yeah. I loved it when he was like, this, unfortunately, is my skin that you see. And Miles was just like, ugh.
Yeah.
We learn in the movie that Dr. Ohn worked at Alchemax and was responsible for bringing over the DNA altered spider from Earth 42 into Earth 1610. Though, honestly, like why a spider was brought through in their experiments is pretty convenient. Of all things, a genetically modified spider. Mm-hmm. That spider, of course, bit Miles. So Dr. Ohn essentially created Spider-Man, but Miles also in turn created the Spot when he caused the Alchemix Collider to explode at the end of the first film. Mm-hmm. I thought that was an interesting twist on the character of the Spot that definitely leveled him up from being a basic villain of the week type of bad guy. Though I will admit that even in his final form at the end of the movie, when he'd absorbed more interdimensional energy from across the multiverse, it was still hard to take a character who literally kicked his own ass as a credible threat.
Yeah. Well, he was just getting used to his powers then, okay? But I see what you mean.
That was just a hilarious scene. I was laughing out loud at that.
Yeah, it was good.
Real quick, want to mention Peter B. Parker, voiced by Jake Johnson. He's not as prevalent in this film as he was in the first one, which is a shame because I thought his humor and dynamic with Miles was a large reason why that movie worked as well as it did.
Yeah, he was nerfed a little bit in this movie, and I get it. They're focusing him on his fatherhood and, you know, him with Mayday, but I do hope in the next movie, I want to see him not in a robe. Like, I want to see him in Spider-Man attire fully.
Yeah. Maybe a baby Bjorn.
Yeah.
But no more robes.
Yes.
And for the brief amount of time he's in this movie, I feel like it's really to show off how cute his kid is. He tries to tell Miles that he's proud of him, but he doesn't exactly support him because he keeps telling him to essentially give up and turn himself into the society. I kind of wish he played a more active role in helping Miles escape Nueva York, or, you know, helping Gwen find a way to traverse the multiverse again. But those roles were largely given to Spider-Bite and Spider-Punk.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And that's what we would have seen from the first movie. And you would expect that as him equating his fatherhood with Mayday to how I need to protect Miles.
Right.
But he didn't get there. Maybe in the next movie. But you're right, because Spider-Punk, he was really kind of the badass that helped let Miles do what he needed to do to continue on.
Right, exactly. And Spider-Punk, aka Hobie Brown, he was voiced by Daniel Kaluuya, who's a great actor. Loved him in Nope. He's fantastic. I didn't even recognize that it was his voice because the British accent was just so heavy. It was kind of hard to understand sometimes what he was saying. But
I wholeheartedly agree.
Yeah, the character was cool, though. He was there kind of to set up a love triangle between, you know, Miles and Gwen and him. And I thought he was a great foil for the character of Miles. Just he was everything that Miles almost wished he could be in a way. Mm-hmm. Someone who was, you know, admired by Gwen at the very least.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I enjoyed that love triangle. I loved seeing Miles get so jealous at him, where Hobie, he didn't give a crap about anything. You know, right. He's Spider-Punk. Yeah. You know, and honestly, we don't even know if anything happened to them. Like, it may not have. Maybe she is just his drummer and that's it.
Right.
And there's no ties to anything, but you know, there could have been. They probably banged.
Well, it was described in the film that Spider-Gwen is older than Miles. I wasn't sure if that was the case because in the first movie, like, they were in school together, but I don't know. Hobie Brown, Spider-Punk, was definitely like the most featured alternate Spider-Man character in the movie. We, of course, also had Jessica Drew, aka Spider-Woman, and Spider-Man India, Pavitar Prabhakar. I totally butchered that. We didn't really get as much as I thought we would out of Jessica Drew. She wasn't nearly as involved or as impressive as I thought she would be, based off of, you know, just the marketing for the film. And Pavitar was really only in that scene where they went to Mumbatan. I thought he would be more prevalent as well, but not so much.
No, it was a visually stunning scene, though. I really liked how it looked, the Mumbatan scene. And it was the crutch of Miles and Spider-Gwen saving the sergeant or whoever it was.
Yeah.
And that here we're seeing the issue that is canon events needing to stay canon. But yeah, I agree. He was just, and yeah, Jessica Drew, just kind of there.
I will say that Karan Soni did a fantastic job voicing Spider-Man India. I love him as Dopinder in the Deadpool films, and I thought he totally pulled off the comedy for this one as well.
Yeah, which, just my little side tangent here, that's also a 5, and you guys only gave it a 4. the first movie is a 5, all right? The second movie is a 4.5, but I don't understand why you wouldn't give Deadpool 1 a 5, just throwing that out there.
I was pretty bitter. Well, that does it for the character breakdown. Let's move on to the story highlights. On Earth 65, 16 months after the destruction of the Alchemix Collider, Gwen Stacy is struggling to live up to the expectations of her policeman father, who does not know that she is Spider-Woman. Years prior, Gwen accidentally killed her best friend, Peter Parker, while he was mindlessly rampaging as the Lizard, and the police have been hunting her ever since. One night, Gwen goes to the Guggenheim Museum in Manhattan after hearing reports of an intruder, only to run into a version of the Vulture that comes from a Renaissance-themed alternate universe. Although I'm not quite sure how he ended up in hers. The Spider People Miguel O'Hara and Jessica Drew arrive using portal-generating watches and help Gwen subdue the Vulture. Gwen is confronted on the scene by her father and reveals her identity to him. He, of course, gets distraught at this revelation, but still attempts to arrest her. She escapes through a dimensional portal with the others after O'Hara begrudgingly grants her membership to the Spider Society. I did think the Vulture here was really cool. Just the design of him. I wanted to see more of that, like, Da Vinci-esque world.
Yeah, that was very fun. I mean, very interesting that you saw immediately in their different universes how the artistic styles are going to be so farther than they were, obviously, in the first movie.
Oh, yeah.
Because everyone came into 1610, and they all looked pretty normal. But now they're taking it to the nth degree. And I thought it was kind of fun. He talked weird, you know, in his little older, like, Italian style. And it was very fun.
Yeah. I mean, I loved the animation style in the first movie. Highly influential, of course. I didn't know what to expect for this film in terms of how they would ramp it up, but they absolutely did. And it was really cool that they were able to do that. Like, everything from, you know, Lego world to this Da Vinci kind of Renaissance style, it was all really well realized. Can't stress that enough. I've said it a few times, but yeah, they did a good job. In Brooklyn on Earth 1610, Miles Morales is adapting to being Spider-Man while missing Gwen and struggling to live up to his parents' expectations. While heading to a parent-teacher evaluation, he encounters the Spot, a scientist whose body was infused with portals after the Alchemix Collider explosion. Blaming Miles for his dilemma, the Spot brings Miles to Alchemax, where he then accidentally transports himself into a void, where he learns to travel to other universes that contain the Alchemix Collider so he can use them to empower himself further.
Man, I just can't get over how fun he was. Their first interaction felt like a comic book interaction. I mean, it felt like the Spider-Man just messing with these villains of the week. Like, they set that up in a kind of a perfect feel for Spider-Man.
Totally. Yeah, their banter made it definitely feel like this was just a goofy kind of villain that Spider-Man was going to dispatch fairly easily. But of course, that goes horribly awry once Spot learns how to travel to other dimensions.
Once he kicked his own ass.
Still a great scene. Gwen travels to Earth 1610 and reconnects with Miles, though she is secretly tracking the Spot across dimensions. Miles secretly watches Gwen trace the villain, after which Drew, Spider-Woman, instructs Gwen to leave Miles behind. Gwen opens a portal, which Miles follows through to Mumbatan on Earth 5101. They encounter Spider-Man Pavitar, Prabhakar and Hobie Brown before confronting the Spot, who successfully absorbs the power of that world's collider, having done the same thing across several other universes prior, slowly growing in power. Miles is struck with a vision of his father dying at the hands of the Spot before the Spot escapes. And again, that vision thing still throws me. I'm not sure why that happened. Very convenient.
Yeah, as we've said before, it's a bit confusing. You know, Miguel is so certain that he is an anomaly, but he has every other thing that screams he is Spider-Man. So
his uncle what is died. It? His uncle died.
Exactly.
In the ensuing destruction of the collider, Miles saves a police captain, the father of Prabhakar's girlfriend. However, Mumbatan then begins falling apart from the disruption of a canon event. Members of the Spider Society arrive to assess the damage of the dimensional anomaly, while Miles, Gwen, Prabhakar, and Brown are sent to their headquarters on Earth 928, where hundreds of Spider-Man variants reside in a massive complex. They meet up with O'Hara and are joined by Peter B. Parker and his daughter Mayday. O'Hara explains how each Spider-Man story contains quote-unquote canon events, such as the death of a police captain, and that strength from those events threatens the fabric of the multiverse.
Yeah, no other movie has done such a good job of tying in the multiverse, I think, as much as even this one. I mean, they give you the visuals of like what you saw in Loki, of the branches and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I am kind of curious, though, like with all these different multiverse police forces between the Spider Society and the TVA, you know, do they not collide? Do they all have like the exact same goal? Actually, the other ones don't, because they're about pruning. And when they pruned everything, was there just one Spider-Man, or was there still the multiverse going on? I don't really know, but it's a little bit wacky. But I do think this one did a better job of helping explain and showing the Spider-Verse stuff and just the overall multiverse stuff way better than even Multiverse of Madness. I liked Multiverse of Madness, thank you. Uh-huh. I think people didn't care for it, but I like Sam Raimi's style, so I'm a big fan. But this one, I thought, did a really good job of kind of explaining how these nodes work, which we saw if you watched What If, like these kind of canon events, kind of the death of his girlfriend, Rachel McAdams' character.
That's true.
So similar kind of stuff. Like it's actually tying in all that other stuff really well.
I guess technically, all of these Spider-Men would not exist if it weren't for the girl Loki at the end of the Loki TV show killing that version of Kang.
Yeah, I mean, I guess these other multiverses spread out, but they just move so quickly and all this other kind of stuff. So it's fine.
Yeah.
Cool with it.
I definitely think that Across the Spider-Verse is Marvel's best multiverse movie. I'll agree with that. At least until, you know, like maybe Deadpool 3 comes out and he gets to traverse the multiverse then.
That's how they're going to end the multiverse stuff. Deadpool kills the MCU multiverse, and that's that.
Why not? It's comic canon. They could do it.
Yeah, they can do whatever.
Now, Miles realizes that his father's death is a canon event. He argues with O'Hara, who imprisons him. Brown helps Miles break loose, then uses a portal to escape the society. O'Hara orders all of the spider people to apprehend Miles, resulting in a long chase through the complex. O'Hara eventually pins Miles down and tells him that he was never supposed to become Spider-Man, as the spider that bit him came from another universe, making Miles the original anomaly and leaving that world with no Spider-Man. Miles flees and, with the help of Spider-Bite Margot Kess, returns to what he believes is his home dimension.
Now, it is kind of curious because he's got this Universe 42 signature on him. That's why the big mechanical spider sent him there.
Right.
But he can't exist in that universe because he's glitching out. But he's got that blood in him, if you will. He's got that something. So it's just kind of interesting.
Yeah, that is weird. If the spider felt that he belonged in that universe, why doesn't the universe feel like he belongs there, I guess? Yeah. Although I just realized how he gets out of the freaking chains. He glitches out of them.
Yeah, that's it.
I figured it out. Solved the puzzle.
I think Spider-Bite, she... Like, you see literally, like, they almost flirt, like, at one time, or something is going on between the two of them, and then she's all of a sudden like, okay, I'm going to help you get out of here. Like, it was like, okay, wow. I mean, yeah, I get it. She wanted her some Miles.
I wonder if she knew that he was going to the wrong universe, because, like, she kind of gave him a look. Initially, I assumed that, she was just, like, was longing for him and wanted to help him or something like that, But now in hindsight, I'm wondering if she was like, wait, why is he going to this universe as opposed to this one? I'm not quite sure.
Yeah. Now, I remember seeing that it sent him to universe 42. Like, I saw that and in my head, I was like, oh, okay, 42. And I knew that he was from 1610. But for some reason in my head, I didn't make that connection like, oh, they're sending him to the wrong universe. But it felt like the twist was still solid and they still did a good job for me when he realized he was not in the right one.
It was still a twist for me. I didn't even catch the whole him going to Earth 42 thing. Now, seeing Gwen as a liability, O'Hara kicks her out of the Spider Society and sends her back to her universe. Gwen reconciles with her father, who has decided to resign as police captain. Gwen decides to aid Miles, leaving Earth 65 with a bootleg portal watch Brown left with her father for her. And she's going to go out and find Miles with this ragtag team of spider people. As Miles arrives back in his apartment, he reveals to his mother that he is Spider-Man, whom she doesn't recognize. After encountering his deceased uncle Aaron Davis and learning that his father has already died, Miles realizes that he is on Earth 42, the homeworld of the spider that bit him. Aaron interrogates Miles and is soon joined by the Miles of Earth 42, who has become the Prowler. O'Hara, Drew, and Ben Reilly travel to Earth 1610 in search of Miles just as the Spot arrives and begins to attack. And that's pretty much how the film ends, with this like kaiju version of the Spot getting ready to attack Manhattan, and Scarlet Spider and Spider-Man 2099 and Spider-Woman on the hunt for Miles in his universe. Meanwhile, Miles is in Earth 42, captured by the alternate version of him, the Prowler, while Gwen is going to go out and search for Miles with, you know, Spider-Man Noir and Spider-Pig and Penny Parker, who are rejoining the team, which is going to be nice to see because I missed me some Spider-Ham.
Yeah, I missed me some Spider-Man Noir. Like, Nick Cage did such a great job with that one. I was kind of hoping we at least get like one line from each of them at the end. Like, you know, let's do this or something. Unfortunately, we didn't get it, but we'll obviously get them in the next movie.
I think we did get a line from Penny Parker, although I can't remember what
we did.
She said.
No, we did. You're right. We got one from Penny, but she's like my least favorite.
Yeah.
She doesn't count.
Again, it was a major cliffhanger. I wish there was a little bit more story, but I guess, you know, what we got is what we got. And it was good. I know I harp on the film and I nitpick on it, but I did really enjoy it. I thought it was a very worthwhile successor to the first film. It's a cinematic work of art, you know, boasting both style and substance with its kinetic boundary pushing animation and, you know, weighty dramatic themes of longing and belonging. I think Marvel fans should be very proud of this movie, and I think it's definitely one of the best Spider-Man films, for sure. I'm giving it the same rating that we gave the first film, 4.5 stars. Of course, the first film probably should have been 5. I'm only knocking it because it did have some, you know, pacing issues, did have a villain problem, was really only half a story. So yeah, still a fresh rating though on Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah, I agree with everything that you just said right there. The film, what it does extremely well. Like, the visuals are cranked up to 11 for this film, and I couldn't help but be absorbed by the impressive work that all the animators did on this. All of the different styles, I loved it. Yeah, it got even a little too much at times, but that didn't detract for the masterpiece of the visual beauty that was brought into this movie. Uh-huh. I would probably be a person that says Into the Spider-Verse is the best Spider-Man movie. I would call it a 5. And I mean, I would still also call probably Spider-Man 2 a 5 for me. But that one, I think, edges it out. And I think by the end of the Spider-Verse trilogy, it will unquestionably be the best Spider-Man trilogy.
Really?
Like,
because a lot of people like No Way Home.
I like No Way Home. I'd say this movie is on par with No Way Home.
Yeah. I mean, like, this film, of course, had Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire in it as well, just like No Way Home, as long as a ton of other cameos, which is always great to see as a comic book fan. I definitely think once this like trilogy, if it's a trilogy, saga is over, I think it'll definitely be hailed as one of the most groundbreaking trilogies in superhero cinema ever. Absolutely. No question.
Yeah. But because of those little knocks, as you've already kind of called out, I don't need to repeat too much, but it's basically what happened to the villain at some point, like who is the villain at some point, and also half the story. Like, I just wanted it all, damn it. I was ready to sit there for so much longer. Like, the cliffhanger I didn't care for. But because Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse should have been a 5, I would call this one a 4.5.
Yeah, Joseph's going to be proud that I didn't rate this film a 4, which I was originally thinking it was going to be. But, you know, after going through all my notes and writing up my review and stuff like that, I definitely think it's better than that. It's a 4.5 for sure.
I mean, great emotion, great storytelling still. And that's the heart of any movie, that you want to come out of it and you were craving more.
Yeah.
Like, that's fantastic storytelling right there.
Exactly. Yeah. And definitely the sign of a good sequel. I have no idea when the next movie is coming out.
Neither do I. I hope it's just within a year. I don't want to wait another 5 years. You know, I would expect that they're obviously working on it and it should be hopefully ready in 2024.
Yeah, it looks like it's March 29th, 2024.
Okay.
That's
all right.
That's a year away, damn it, practically. Whatever. But I guess, you know, we have plenty of other superhero media to hold us over, including The Flash in a few weeks, which I'm going to get a head out and say that the comparisons between these two films are going to be inevitable. Chris Miller and Phil Lord both worked on these movies, and they both have very similar plot points to them. I do think that people are going to respond to this movie better, just because I think a lot of people have already made up their mind about Ezra Miller.
Yeah, well, it's hard not to. I mean, the guy is a tool bag. He's a whole bag of tools. And you get double the Ezra Miller, and who wants that?
The movie's not bad. I've seen
it. Oh, I'm sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure it's going to be good.
I'm definitely curious to hear what you think of it once you see it. Are you planning on seeing it in theaters?
Oh, yeah. I mean, my nostalgia for a Michael Keaton Batman is absolutely high enough to go see that film. So good. I'll be there.
Good. All right. Well, it's honestly like another Olympus Has Fallen, White House Down, Armageddon, Deep Impact kind of situation. It's kind of bizarre. And I really kind of regret watching The Flash prior to seeing Across the Spider-Verse. But we'll talk all about that in our Flash review in 2 weeks. Thanks, Adam, for coming on board and helping me review this film with Joseph's absence. Cannot think of a better co-host for this film. I know you love film, and I know you love Marvel, unfortunately. Not going to hold that against you, though. You were a great, great co-host. So, appreciated.
Thank you very much for having me. I really do enjoy every time I've been on. If anybody doesn't remember my voice last time I was on the show, I had COVID and I was like really scratchy and you couldn't understand. This is how I actually sound. And I hope I sound a little bit better for y'all. So I hope you liked it.
Yeah, we finally got you on for like a good film. Because in the past, it was always just like films that we just love to rag on.
I do want to plug, just in case anybody hasn't gone to the Blast from Our Past and listened to the episodes that you and Joseph have been on. You've both been on multiple episodes.
Yes.
But in particular, you guys have to check out the first time we had you guys on. We talked Batman the Animated Series and the X-Men Animated Series together.
Yeah.
And then we did some fun castings as well. That was one of our best episodes still to date, I would have to say. But we had a lot of fun with you coming on for Batman and Joseph coming on for Howard the Duck. It's always a pleasure when Dynamic Duel and Blast from Our Past get together.
Yeah. Always good times. Definitely check out those episodes. Also check out Adam's other podcasts, Cartwright, a Seinfeld podcast, and of course, Throwback Trivia Takedown. You will not be disappointed. I give you my Johnny DC guarantee.
Wow. That doesn't mean much because you're a DC fan.
Oh, what the heck? All right. Not having any of that here. Not when I'm in charge of this episode. That does it for this review. Let us know what you thought about the movie by writing to us at dynamicduelpodcast@gmail.com or by visiting us on Instagram or Twitter. You can find links to all of our accounts by checking out our show notes or visiting our website, dynamicduel.com. On our site, you can also find a link to our Patreon page, where you can join our Dynamic 2O tier and chat with us and fellow listeners, our Fantastic 4 tier, which gets you bonus content each month, our X-Force tier, that makes you an executive producer of this podcast, or our newest tier, that lets you join our Dynamic Podcast Network. If you can't join Patreon, you can still support the show by signing up for our e-newsletter, also at dynamicduel.com. Please rate the show on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Podchaser, or on our website. In our next episode, which is bookended by films that involve the multiverse, both Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse and The Flash, we've decided to do a multiversal duel, sort of similar to what we did last year with a few of our episodes like Batman Beyond and Spider-Man 2099, or The Batman Who Laughs against Cosmic Ghost Rider. Next week, we're going to find out who's going to win in a duel between Kingdom Come Superman and Maestro, the older evil Hulk. So look forward to that. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Joseph should be back. So I guess also look forward to that. I'm not really, but that does it for this episode. We want to give a big thanks to our executive producers, Ken Johnson, John Starosky, Zachary Hepburn, Dustin Belcom, Miggy Mathengian, Brendan Estergaard, Nathaniel Wagner, Levi Yatin, Nick Abanto, Austin Wesolowski, AJ Dunkerley, Scott Camacho, Adam Spies, and Zach Wilder for making this podcast possible. And we'll talk to you guys next week. Up, up, and away!
True believers,